Just to before we start off, I'll make a quick introduction of you. So friends, Naresh ji has been a veteran in the pharmaceutical industry. He spent 35 years and has worked with companies like GlaxoSmithKline, brand vaccine, and his last stint with Sava Healthcare, where he made sure that the company reached a turnover of close to 100 crores as a CEO of the company. He has been instrumental in terms of building various pharmaceutical brands. Right now, he is very highly involved in training and facilitating processes in terms of management. He has done his PTP general management course and has also done a leadership program from the institute. Today, he is here to share his experience, which he's seen over a period of time with, you know, inspiring leaders in sales management, in changing times, in employee engagement, customer delight, brand building, and of course, you know, about being a very, very good leader. Naresh ji, I'll hand over this to you. I'm going to be muting everybody else except for you. I request everybody to mute themselves and to turn off their camera. The reason we're asking you to turn off the camera except for Naresh ji, everybody requests to turn off your camera is because of the food consumption, the buffering which happens. Everybody's camera and mic will be off except for Naresh ji. Naresh ji, you are center screen. You can always share your screen. I know you have a presentation. So this is over to you, Naresh ji. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Rashesh. Very good evening. I think I'll wait for the people to get on mute. Yeah.
I'll do it. Don't you go ahead.
Yeah. So a very, very good evening to all of you and a very special welcome. Saturday evening, you know, for a session is unheard of in the western part of the world. I think after 3 o'clock or 4 o'clock on Fridays, I think people are found in the pub and not on the Zooms. But we are now in a situation, you know, where we are always on Zoom. So welcome. I wish to thank Mr. Ashish, you know, for presenting this opportunity to speak to all of you. I think, you know, it's not that I am a very well learned man. I think I have experience where I have observed people and I have had the fortune of reading some very good authors. I think and that has helped me assimilate a lot of, knowledge, which can be of value. So let me share the screen and... Yeah. So I think, you know, right now we will go through some slides. And since, you know, this is a little longer session, we will take pause at frequent intervals to try and recap, you know, some of the, you know, issues presented by various authors and my own readings. And then we will continue with the second section and similarly till we complete the slides. And then there will definitely be an opportunity for us to interact. As Mr. Ashish has mentioned. So I think the title, I thought of choosing the title as the DNA of entrepreneur. So I think the first thing which comes to mind is whether this DNA is genetically transferred or it can be, created. So the DNA may not be the very right way to describe an entrepreneur because many people have actually, you know, become entrepreneurs on their own without a family history. But then once they have become entrepreneurs and succeeded, then they have definitely shown some traits, some qualities which have helped them immensely. Not only the people who I have seen in my 37 years career, but also, if you read books like Good to Great from Jim Collins, and if you read Built to Last, where it's all about, those companies, which really built a great company for years to come. And it's all talking about, people behind the company. So before we get into the presentation, good practice to acknowledge, that the contents and thoughts presented by me are a seamless integration, of experience over 37 years journey, as well as knowledge gained from books, particularly very highly credible authors like Jim Collins, Business Today, and some good books on customer service. So I wish to thank the authors, for this learning, which I have been able to acquire. Now, you know, when we think about leaders globally, there are big leaders, you know, obviously, but in this session we have picked up few leaders to talk about. So the first person, you know, I thought of talking about of is Kiran Majumdar Shaw. I'm sure many of you would be aware of what she's doing now. She happens to be, you know, the richest woman in India and also the owner and chairperson of Biocon, the company, you know, which started not very, very, you know, ages ago. The purpose of putting this lady on the screen is, you know, when she started immediately after her 12th and all, her ambition was to become a doctor. I think because she tried a lot, she came from a good family, couldn't get into the medical, was very disheartened and feeling very, very sad because, you know, obviously, you know, if you have a dream and sometimes that dream gets shattered, I think it's a barrier. She tried one more career. Her father, you know, was, you know, also today is, you know, a master brewer in the brewing industry in United Breweries. He advised him because of her, you know, inclination with science and biology, you know, to look, take a hand at brewing. So she did that, but over a few years' time, she realized that that the heart and soul was not in that business. Now, two points in life early on where, you know, you feel that you're not in the right place can be a very, you know, bad barrier to your mind and to growth. I think what she has talked in the book, you know, is that her father gave her one line advice. And that one line advice was that failure is temporary, but giving up is permanent. You know, if we fail, there is again an opportunity for us to get back on our feet and start all over again. But if our mind completely switches off and says, you know, that I'm now unable to do anything, then there is an issue. So this is one quality, you know, which is very important of our mind being in our control. I think moving to another very powerful story. I think the powerful story why I'm saying is, I'm sure everyone in India respects this gentleman. I think one of the companies, you know, which has passed on huge amount of their, you know, earnings to philanthropy. But some of us who are reading about these people would be knowing that Mr. Azim Premji started or was pushed into business at the age of 21. When suddenly he lost his father. And at that point in time, Wipro as a company was into vegetable oil. They were making vegetable oil and the company was in very bad shape in terms of the finances, in terms of the sales, in terms of the margins, etc. Now, Azim Premji at that age of 21 got one advice, you know, again, this is from his own family, from his mother, who, you know, understood that he is very young, but he needs to be motivated. And he was told that please go against the current and listen to advice from everyone, not only the board members, not only the management staff, but also talk to, you know, those people who are at the bottom of your pyramid, who can give you some good advice. I think that's, you know, what Azim Premji did. And then he got into not only software first, but he got into the products first. Whereas the trend was people were getting into software, he got into products first and then into software. And today I think again, a company which is a very, very well respected company globally. So coming, you know, to the DNA of the entrepreneur, I'm sure, you know, all of us will agree to these, you know, elements which are mentioned there, which contribute, you know, or constitute the DNA. I think the number one absolutely is leadership. Now, leadership normally is understood as leading people, and leadership and management difference sometimes is, you know, talked as management is mainly doing things right, and leadership is about managing people right. But leadership is also, you know, about finding out a great business idea and having, you know, the resilience to execute that idea till it succeeds over a period of time. Then very important thing is, you know, once you have an idea, then of course, you know, we have to have a strategy. Now, in case of, you know, talent corner, maybe it's possible that strategy is being, you know, designed by the head office or the parent company. But still, there may be a good opportunity, you know, for us to look at small, you know, things which we can do at our, I think, our end as, you know, the franchisees. Which would be termed as strategy to build our business. And then comes to a very important aspect, you know, for running the business is the mindset. We will be spending a lot of time on mindset and customer. I think these are the two areas, you know, where I think the whole presentation is going to be focused on. A few slides, of course, on leadership and strategy will be there and on people. So now coming to the strategy, I think the first, you know, thing is sometimes when we get into a business, you know, we tend to suddenly get into a lot of action and not get a little back and see the big picture in terms of, you know, what's going on in the environment, what is the competitor scenario, what are the customers wanting, how many customers, you know, am I having on my radar. Out of that, like those things become the big picture. And then dealing with strategic issues, we'll come to that very quickly in the next slides. I think a strategy is always companies like, you know, pharmaceutical companies started first with the metro, then it went into the tier one, tier two, tier three. Today, almost everyone has reached into the rural markets. And then creating, you know, really a differentiation. That's, you know, what the important part of strategy is. So the most important two pieces here are, you know, creating competitive differentiation and dealing with strategic issues when it comes to strategy. Now, very simply defined, you know, strategy, the books are there, you know, which are very big and very complicated. But it simply said it's like a plan of action that will help me differentiate my company or my service. And that difference, I should not value. The value should be seen by the customer. I mean, it could be a set of 10 small things which are different offerings, which I am doing, you know, as a franchisee or a HR recruitment provider, which others may not be doing. And that could be a strategy where it can take me to the ultimate goal where I want to take my company to. Examples. We will discuss when it comes to the, you know, specific slides on what small things, you know, we're talking about. Now, when we formulate strategy, we need to look most important, you know, part of the element of the strategy is the customer and the environment. I mean, in this particular business, you know, of recruitment and providing talent, I think if we try to get into the seats of our customers and try to see what helps in their jobs. What is it that I can do to make their jobs easy? I think is going to get us, you know, to finding some answers for the strategy. And then, you know, is that need, I am able to fulfill that need based on, you know, what the capabilities and resources that I have in my company within. I mean, of course, other last two are very easy. We brainstorm alternatives and then agree on actions and activities. But the most critical part here is, you know, how I can make the job of my customer partner easy. How can I release some of the tensions that they are going through because of vacancies or some, you know, heavy talent turnover or attrition, whatever we call it. I mean, what small things? I mean, this is not an interactive session. Otherwise, ideally, you know, we could have had a flip chart and wrote down what small things can be done. Now, I mean, one is, you know, to update my client before even he asks me what's happening to these three positions. I mean, there could be a shared Google Doc, you know, which gives them an update in the morning and the evening without their, you know, wanting to take out 5 minutes to call us. and give them an update. And the small thing could be, you know, if the issue which is getting precipitated now and then is that the candidate doesn't turn up for the interview, or worst come worst, you know, he turns up for the interview and gets a job and again within a month leaves. That is, you know, a very painful thing, you know, for all, because, you know, you also lose, the customer gets more frustrated and lose. So a little more research, a little more, you know, really talking 5 more minutes or 10 more minutes to the candidate to really understand what is driving him to change the job. What is it that he really likes? And the company which I am offering him, does the company have those sets of values and behaviors and environment that the attrition is less likely to happen? I think 5-10 minutes spent here, I think reduces a lot of stress at everybody's end. I think most of us, you know, whether we are CMDs or we are managing directors or CEOs, I have always went and met customers. In a month, 6-7 days, I have always went and met customers. When I come back from the meetings, I invariably do a small thing, you know, a simple three-line email capturing what was highlighted by the customer to give him 2 messages. One is, you know, that at my level also, this is important. And second message that I have understood what is important to you and I'll work on that. I mean, very, very few people are nowadays even picking up a phone and wishing each other on important occasions. WhatsApp and Facebook has become the medium. We have lost human voice. We have lost human touch. So I think getting back to Archie's shop and picking up a lovely card to say thank you, or picking up a birthday card to, you know, appreciate a customer would be really wonderful. And most importantly, as a strategic differentiation, you know, the strategic differentiation is about research. If you do some more, 2 steps of, you know, doing a check on credentials, do some intelligence, you know, around the candidate and give a small paragraph beyond, you know, your interview observations. I mean, these things might be valued. Again, you know, most things, if you are doing it already, I think I'm very glad. And if you feel even one small thing, you know, it can be added, it could be of value. Now, coming to the mindset, you know, here I think a lot of time can be spent. When we say mindset, I really, when talking about, you know, all of us, including me, myself, have observed, you know, that we have an inner voice. We have an inner voice which tells us sometimes, oh, this is too difficult. Don't get into this. This is something new. You don't know. You don't know how to get into, you know, creating a website. For me, I'm saying, so don't try. So that mind says that, oh, these are the areas, you know, where you are closed to even exploring. You don't really want to get into those areas which you don't know. So that, you know, mindset is a little different mindset. But what mindset, you know, is really required is, you know, a mind which has got this growth orientation. Growth orientation is not about business growth, but I think if I am unable to do more research on the clients because of the way I am not able to reach the right people and not get the right feedback, and I think that is not my job, that is the job of the HR, then I can, you know, grow into that aspect and add value. Then comes the, you know, second aspect of solution thinking. I worked in the last company where, you know, we had a lot of challenges. And every time I used to have a challenge, I used to have 2-3 people in the leadership team come and, you know, talk about what went wrong for 15 minutes, 20 minutes, and the environment used to be so negative. So, I mean, we decided as a group that if anything goes wrong, or if there's any challenge of cash flow or material suddenly not coming in the last minute, I think the whole purpose of meeting me and the group will be to find a solution and not, you know, try and find out who went wrong and who is to be blamed. I mean, that doesn't lead us anywhere. And then the last part, you know, is very important. Again, the same thing as the mindset is resilience. You know, if on a tree, there are two people hanging and like tiger is there down. I mean, the guy who hangs a little longer is going to save his life. I think the resilience is simply saying, you know, how you can stay a little longer than what your mind or what your mind is stating. Now the time to quit. So, I mean, I would say have a little longer stay to see the business really grow. Now, the growth mindset, which I was talking about, says, you know, my intuition or my voice says at this age, you know, after having done a CEO's role, I'm now getting into a business consultancy leader. So which I need to do a lot of marketing through Instagram, social media, which I may not be very good at. But if my mind keeps saying that I can never do that, then it is going to come in the way of my business. I mean, I can think of saying, let me try. I'll figure out. I'll talk to people, my junior people, my daughter, my son, who can teach me this. There used to be, you know, reverse mentoring in companies where junior people used to mentor senior people on new things, you know, which older generations, you know, may not be so comfortable with. So I think the mindset, if it's a growth mindset, it is really good. I think the chain mindset is, you know, going to create blockage. So that is, you know, absolutely something, you know, which should be reflected on. If anything is coming again and again in your mind and allowing you not to try something new, then it's good to, you know, reflect and try and take control of that in emotion and see how you can try 1, 2, 3 things. And then, you know, maybe that whole habit changes. I think, you know, the biggest obstacle, what I have read in a very nice book is, you know, not physical obstacles that we come across. Certainly cash flow is not there. Certainly, you know, a last minute import is failing. I think it's not the biggest barrier. The biggest barriers are actually created by our own minds. I think that is where, you know, a lot of opportunity lies, because what we can, this is a control or influence zone. There's a zone which is where I cannot influence the environment, the government, I cannot influence. So whatever I can influence, I can control. Now, we take a small break because there are a few slides. And, you know, I would urge you, because after 30 slides, it will become a little difficult, you know, to recollect all the things. So here, you know, I'm not opening up, you know, a discussion. I'll just open up the chat and just request, you know, if people would like to, just one or two words, they would like to comment, saying, you know, that what is it that they liked so far? One word, it could be one word, two words, you know, whatever, you know, is... there, maybe 1 minute exercise, we can do that. Yeah, I'm very happy to read a few inspirational and good presentation. Motivational, yeah, improves the thought process, yes. Mentoring is a very good thought of juniors mentoring the seniors, very inspirational, thank you. Now, I think we have understood what's going on. I would stop and request, you know, you to also reflect on some action points, you know, which you might like to take. Like, you know, when we said formulating strategy, that what is it that I can do to create a small differentiation in my service to the client. So if there are a few actionables which you would like to take, you know, from here, that would be wonderful. I think, you know, that would be really wonderful to me, because that is where, you know, in the IITD course, which I did for about 4 months, you know, every Saturday, Sunday, I used to come from Pune and do this course. The champion, who's the Dr. Rajan, the court champion trainer, he started the session with one line. He told me, okay, Naresh, if anytime we are doing any session, if before the session and after the session, there is no change in the behavior of the participants, then that session is not good. It's not, it's, he used the word which is useless. So I'm sure, you know, the purpose of these sessions, what Rashesh is really investing in, is we need to, you know, respect and accept, you know, that yes, very few people like Rashesh, you know, would be adding so much value within one day, 1 week, two good sessions, you know, are happening. I also attended a few and found them very, very good sessions. So I think action points would be good to, you know, remember. And we come to the next slide now. We have talked about the growth mindset. We have, you know, talked about this. The biggest obstacles being sometimes our own mind barriers. Now, reading books, you know, started for me in 2000, which is still, you know, 20 years late in my career and life. But once I started reading, I realized, you know, that I could have been a much better manager if I would have started reading when I was maybe, you know, 25, 28, 29. So this Good to Great is a masterpiece. It's an old book. It's a masterpiece. It talks about two concepts. It talks about disciplined people, disciplined thought, and disciplined actions. I think once, you know, you have decided that this is, you know, what I and my team will do for the customer, then no changing tracks, no digression from there. If any thought comes, you know, which is saying, okay, this customer is absolutely ridiculous, is again and again creating problems for me, let me shift from this customer to somewhere else. So that is not a disciplined thought. The disciplined thought is, I think the word challenging, most challenging customer, if I win, I think then once you win this type of a customer, then for a long time, you know, this customer is going to be with you. I mean, once you have decided the strategic actions, disciplined actions is very, 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 very important to, you know, remember. And then the next one is very interesting. This one is extremely interesting. Now, you know, it talks about three qualities. You know, Mr. Jim Collins has described level 5 leadership in that book. You know, if you don't buy the whole book, I'm sure a small presentation is available on Google, which will tell you, it talks about, you know, 5 levels of a manager. One is, you know, he's an individual player, then he becomes a team leader. Then, you know, he's looking at the business. Then he's, you know, looking at something, you know, which is now and future. Talking about, you know, current business and looking at 5 years down the line. That is what the managing director does. That is what, you know, the CEO might be doing. Now, in that level, the three qualities, you know, which he says differentiated people who are running big organizations, you know, were, one is professional will. Now, we'll come to this a little in detail. And personal humility. And obviously, I mean, if you are into scientific work and if you don't have functional competency, you have only will, you may not succeed. So functional competency is base. It's a base given. Now, professional will has come from that word will, which says two things. One thing it says is, what will I do? And the second is, what will I do, come what may? I will do this, come what may. I think this is the will. I have to reach this vision in 3 years' time. And I will do all that I have in my resources to reach there. A professional will, I would give one example, which I know personally. Personal humility I saw in plenty. I saw in plenty in a company like Glaxo, where the managing director will, you know, not feel, you know, a little bit awkward also to come across to your cabin or a cubicle also and talk to you for 10 minutes and ask, rather than telling his secretary to order to call somebody. I mean, personal humility for me, I learned, you know, when I used to go to big doctors and meet them, I always learned that the doorkeeper is extremely important. As a humility is, you know, to talk to that Prakash very nicely, giving him the same respect, not telling him that, you know, you are only a doorkeeper. I mean, many of our, you know, CEOs, you know, or chiefs of this franchisee might be going to meet the HR head. but there are three people below the head, and there is one lady, administrative lady, also below that. Many times, you know, the head of the HR tells this lady or the down the lady that, you know, please quickly organize these two vacancies. And then the decision might be taken actually much down the line. It may not be taken by the HR head. So personal humility helps us, have a good rapport with the entire chain. I came back from Lupin, you know, a meeting with the procurement head in 2018. And I had met seven people in that chain, you know, to discuss opportunities for us to supply contract manufacture for them. I mean, I came back and despite my busy schedule, all the seven fellows, I sent an email thanking them for their time. The content and the length and the breadth of the emails were all the same. So it makes a difference because these people really remember you then. And then, of course, I'm not talking about functional competency because I'm not at all there. I think that is Rashesh and you all. Now, I want to talk to you about this gentleman. I think this gentleman, you know, is less known to a lot of people, but me and moms may be known. Me and moms, Mimi, this company might be now known. Now, why I have picked up this guy is like a distant relative as well as a great friend for me. He started with one very big store in Juhu and a lot of investment. A man, you know, self-made man, completely self-made man, starting from the scratch to a big store, which was in the basement of this mini market, you know, which is on the road a little ahead of Mithibai College in Mumbai. I think we all remember, you know, the flooding that happened in Bombay, in the 2000 early years. What happened is, in that particular flooding, the entire basement stores, you know, were completely submerged in water for 3-4 days as nobody, you know, could get out from houses and travel on the roads. Finally, when the waters receded, this gentleman actually reached the shop, and when he saw that almost 100% of the goods, which are all, you know, very delicate goods meant for babies, are all completely destroyed. I think your mind can, do anything. Your mind can, you know, tell you to, I mean, just run away from there and forget about business. And his staff was there. And what I learned from Mr. Naresh was, he said that I told my staff that on the third day, our shop will open. On the third day, the shop will open. And whatever is there in our godowns will be in the shops. And whatever is like gone is gone. So I mean, that kind of mindset I may not have. But I can share with you that there is a lot of people who have that kind of a mindset, and maybe a great mindset to have. Now, as I was talking to you about my own experience, you know, I have seen people drive their cars 80% of the time looking at the rear view mirror. I mean, you can't drive like that. I mean, you can drive 10%, 5% time looking at the rear view. What happened? What happened? What happened? But your job is to look in the, you know, front screen and drive. So if you are having anybody meeting you and, you know, going back and back in the reverse to, you know, talk about problems and who's responsible for that, I think don't allow it. In the business, I think this rear view can be actually removed, or a very small one can be there, which can help us also, you know, learn from where we went wrong. That is a good way to reflect and, you know, to learn from there. Now, coming to the word, you know, which was the resilience word, I think it talks about, in a day, there are competing priorities. And I come to the office as a CEO and there is so many priorities. And then I have said, oh my God, I came and I met the top people of Lupin and need to write 7 mails myself. It cannot be through my secretary, because I know what words I have to use for a different person. And then, you know, I decide that between 9 and 11, I will not allow anything unless there is a fire. Unless there is a fire in the office, or unless really somebody is close to dying because of a medical emergency, nobody can talk to me between 9 and 11. In that time, I will do what is important for me. So that I used to call private time. And I used to tell my direct reportees also to not allow a lot of interference between 9 to 11. try to keep focused on what is your big ticket issues and do that. Then, I mean, barriers, which business doesn't have barriers? I think, we would be very lucky in this kind of environment now. I think the environment is going to be different after the lockout opens, whenever it opens. The barriers will be immense. I think the companies will have challenges in terms of, money. It's also possible a lot that, the companies would like to recoup what is lost by investing a lot in terms of becoming more, aggressive in reaching the market. So both can happen. So, I mean, as a leader, we have to be able to show to our teams and to our company that how we can deal with these setbacks. And of course, perseverance, is part of all this. Now, we can again take a small pause. And, I'll just quickly rush through, go back to a few slides, and stop wherever, Yeah, so we talked about disciplined people, disciplined thought, disciplined actions, professional will, humility, more important, and functional competence. Yeah. So now we are moving to a very interesting part. Before that, maybe again we do a 2 minutes of chat where you can mention what you really felt can be becoming part of your agenda, can be becoming part of your day-to-day activity. That will be nice. Yeah. Good is the biggest enemy of great is the starting line of the book. The book starts with this word that good is the enemy of great. Yeah, future orientation, yes. Only forward journey, yes. Yeah, whatever it takes, absolutely. Whatever it takes is, those guys, who have completely turned around the businesses. Discipline is important, resilience is important, very good. I'm very glad, that some of these, are, it's a more of a, a refresher. I think I'm sure all of us know this, but in the activity, there is so much activity and lot of such activity is not leading to productivity. So we need to know what is it that really we need to be, focused on. Thanking the clients, absolutely. I think even instead of a WhatsApp message, today, if I get a card in which I have written in my own hand, it will be more valued because my staff, 375 staff of Sava Healthcare on all the 3 years got a Diwali greeting card, which was signed by me and written by me for all the 3 years, which they had never experienced in this kind of era. So, I mean, it takes a little time, but then you build a bond. I mean, 80-20 principle is absolutely another great book written, where 20% of the effort gives you 80% of the result. And 80% of the activity sometimes may be not really desiring that much of time. It may not be really requiring that kind of time. So thank you very much for this. Let us now move to the topic, which is of importance and really the importance. I saw one comment saying that how do we differentiate and what are the pros and cons of differentiation? I saw that, as a comment in the chat. So first of all, why do we need to be customer centric? Why should we be customer centric? Is it because he is only, paying us some 10% or 13.333? I don't know how much is the number now. Or what is it that, this guy should be our partner for? What is it, that companies are doing? Now, I have a book in front of me, which is, called Samnay, which is a company, Abbott, very big amongst the top one company, number one company after the merger in India pharmaceuticals. Their procurement director considers each and every contract supplier as a partner. And they call once in a year a meeting in a place, Delhi or Hyderabad or Goa, where all the vendors, irrespective of how much they contribute, are invited with a focus on one thing: how can the partnership be strengthened you understand our problems and I understand your problems. The problems of the customers are, if you don't give me the material on the date, I mean, my marketing fellows and salespeople are killing me. I think as a procurement guy, I'm supposed to give them products on time. And if I don't give the product on time in the pharmacy, my product is prescribed, but some other guy is taking away the business because that pharmacy is not going to leave the customer. He gives the product which is available. So they brought us to understand, okay, what support do you want? So there are companies like Maruti Udyog and all who actually invested in vendors so that they build the capability of the vendors and they become better partners. So here we don't require that kind of partnering where we want funds from them, but we need to have a partnership because both of us have a same goal. I think the goal is very clear for me, for both the customer and for the franchisee of Talent Corner, that we have to strengthen that organization by giving them good talent at the right, you know, CTC and on time. I mean, if I give these three things to them, then I don't have attrition. I mean, I build that organization grows. And if this year they gave me 20 assignments, then the next year they may go and give me 25 assignments. If they don't grow, if I give the wrong people and the people are not contributing, then they don't grow. And next year, I mean, they may not tell us, but I mean, we will also not grow. And what we want from them, we want a better brief. We want a better, written down job JD that, you know, I would like to see the JD. I would like to see what all you are expecting from me. I mean, do you want me to do the, you know, the what do you call it as a reference check also? Do you want me to look at the certificates also? Because the certificates are being forged. I mean, I had two cases in my earlier company where people came with certificates which were forged. And the headhunter did not notice it, but our HR noticed it. I would have been happier if the headhunter would have noticed it. So it would have been less trouble for all of us, you know, to have called these fellows to Pune and then found out that there's something wrong. So coming to the issue is, you know, that both of us have a common goal. We describe the common goal is what partners are all about. Now, when we started, you know, with this slide, customer-centric culture. The concentric culture means in the entire scheme of things, in the center, the customer is sitting. I think nowadays many companies are, you know, having this open door policy where, you know, chairmen and MDs also are coming out of their, you know, closed cabins. And one MD decided to sit in the center of the office so that he can see everybody, everybody can see him, everybody can reach him. So this centric, you know, city has become a real new thing now. So the vision has, you know, now we come into, you know, if I have to have a customer-centric organization, then who is going to decide that? I mean, I may not have a 10 people fleet in the company, but first I have to decide it with a vision. A vision is very simple and a focused one line message that this is, you know, what I will be known for as a company by not one client. I mean, it can be the smallest client or it can be the biggest client. So when I moved around, you know, in Sava, I used to go to Hyderabad to meet a client who used to buy 10 lakh rupees of goods in the whole year, as against McLeod's, you know, who used to buy around 1 crore goods of worth a year also. I mean, some trees, you know, you'll have to nurture today. They will start giving you returns after 3 years, 2 years. But that's how the business is. Everybody is unable to give the same business now. But if you have access to some companies, I think that itself is great. I mean, I used to get 10 mails, you know, with somebody from LinkedIn that we would like to start supplying people to you. But I unfortunately couldn't see those mails also because we already had people. So if you are already having access to companies, if you are having access to databases, then, you know, it's good to create a customer-centric vision, simple, focused, a mix of reality and aspiration. At this juncture, you know, if I say that I would like to become a world-class partner, and I know that right now, I mean, there is some challenge, I would like to go step by step. I mean, at least in 5 years' time, 3 years' time, what is possible, I can, you know, put in my vision statement. And if that vision statement has come out of me, out of my own brain, then I believe in that and I have commitment to that. And then, you know, this issue of will, that, you know, come what may, I will, you know, try and implement that vision. And then one interesting, you know, point, my daughter is an entrepreneur already for the last 3.5 years. I mean, she did her architecture's master's and then she started something on her own and she taught me this concept. She said, Daddy, you need to keep adding value every time. I think the wow feeling comes from the customer, you know, when your customer says, hey, this is a little better, Rushesh, than what I saw last time. And then, you know, that relation and the rapport starts getting built. So if you have 10 things in your pocket, in the first visit, maybe we give him 4, 5, another 2 or 3 you add, again you add and make him realize that, you know, you can keep adding value to his business. Now, again, a very good book. There's a, you know, a book titled What Clients Love, Not Like. You know, like and love is the difference. I mean, the difference is very clear. You know, like, I love Cadbury chocolate, Cadbury dairy milk, which means it is not substitutable. I cannot take anything else for Cadbury. I mean, the toothpaste for me may not be, you know, I love. I mean, I can take this time Pepsodent and the next time I can take Colgate. That's fine. But when I love something, I do not switch. I do not switch. So the first thing the customer loves, you know, is integrity. Now, integrity is not financial integrity here. You know, where we know you in GSK, we learned from the beginning, I think no false reporting and no charging expenses wrong. That was integrity. But here, you know, the integrity is whatever word we have given, that should translate into the deed. That is the integrity we are talking about. I mean, very clear. I'm sorry. I was actually trying to remove this. So then, you know, what happens is if you do 8 times, 10 times, you match what you said, then they can predict that, yes, Satish is going to, you know, deliver this time also. He's not going to, you know, put me down. So integrity is about jo bola hai, wo hoga. Jo bola hai, wo karenge. So that is, you know, the integrity. The second, you know, is about openness. Now, openness is a, you know, foundation of every great relationship. So a couple is getting married and they met each other and they have had 2 rounds of coffee in Starbucks. And there, what is required is, you know, that they tell certain things about themselves to the other guy, which they feel, which I think, you know, they should both know about certain things, you know, which are important to know. No hiding. So that founds the basis of trust. Honesty, I mean, in terms of openness, if something I have goofed up, I have missed out, and, you know, something went wrong in the product in the last stage, and my vendor is asking, sorry, my customer is asking me that your delivery schedule is 17th and today 15th, you're not telling the date. Now, instead of telling him, nene, there's going to be a little delay, I think openness is, please tell him that, you know, the last part of the batch is failed and I think we are in a little bit of trouble. Give us 7 days. We will come back to you. I'll try to make it 6 days, but 7 days may happen. But from the 17th to 19th to 21st, if you keep telling him that we are trying, I mean, then, you know, the frustration will mount. It will be, you know, too much for that guy to handle. Now, here, you know, you're not talking about a great sacrifice. You know, you're talking about somebody, you know, suddenly resigned on a Thursday or a Friday, and you got a call on a Friday saying that, oh my God, this is a very critical position. And can you do something by Tuesday? Now, the only sacrifice we are looking at, you know, is that can you do something on the weekend also? I mean, the clients are working, your target audience is working, you are working, and do something a little extra stretch to, you know, try and get back to this guy instead of Tuesday on Monday. That I found 3 CVs. 6 hours of search to find the 2 CVs which are looking like good, and give him the message on Monday morning. So he said, all right, I give you this on Friday evening. So you sacrificed your weekend. You were supposed to actually go to Prithvi Theatre and you did not go. So that was a sacrifice. But then you build a solid bond with a customer and I'm sure it will make a lot of difference. Now, give and take, you know, the phrase itself starts with give. It doesn't take and give. It says give and take. So how long to give? How much to give? I mean, it's a, you know, a challenging answer, but I think, you know, for business to, you know, develop, you and I will have to give a lot of time and a little experience to the customer, you know, that, yes, this is, you know, what I can expect from this guy. Now, I think I have, you know, always, you know, had a different way of approaching this slide, but in this kind of sessions, it cannot be. So if you were to look at, you know, who are the people, you know, who are really giving a lot before taking back or giving a lot and then not, you know, getting back anything because of the nature sometimes being so rude, you know, are the farmers. I think we are not as worst as or as, you know, bad as this category. I mean, the saddest thing, you know, happens is that they have taken loans from, you know, those financial places where, you know, it charges 18%, 16% interest, and then the rain comes suddenly at a wrong time and ruins the crop. Whereas, you know, we give something to a customer for 6 months and then we start feeling bad that, you know, I'm still not getting the business. And some customer may take 1 year, but after that, for 10 years, he's going to give you business. After that, for 8-10 years, he's going to increase his business every year for you. So maybe a good idea, you know, to, you know, give first and then take. Now, we talked about humility earlier, but one more dimension I read, you know, in this book about humility was, I think sometimes, you know, we get excited and talk a little more about ourselves because, you know, that's how we can establish ourselves. But sometimes blowing our trumpet a little loudly can, you know, mean a little offense to the customer also. And sometimes, you know, we may say, oh, but this company you are working with is not giving you this service. Now, that person has been working with that company for the last 5 years and he has a bond with them. So don't touch that bond. You increase your bond, you make your bond stronger and see how, you know, you start getting, you know, better. I mean, if we were a customer and we were to go, you know, to a store and that guy is trying to push one brand over the other, you know, that happens very much in, you know, these electronics shops. And these fellows try to run down the other model. And the minute they do that, I think we start doubting whether, you know, he's got an interest in this brand or this brand is genuinely good for me or no. So I think best is to get out of this area and, you know, keep focusing on what we can deliver. Under promise, deliver more. Under promise, deliver more is the mantra which helps in you know, customer service. Now, I think we come to a very interesting slide. I think, you know, we'll talk about this. Which is the relationship, you know, which actually can be considered, you know, as a very strong bond. So we'll get back to the chat session. And you say, yeah, this relation is, you know, something, you know, which is a great bond. Is it the prime minister and his team, or is it the doctor and the patient, or which is that? Wow. Wow. Mother and child. Wow. Yeah. Then what is the other relationship which, you know, I think takes a lot of time to build a relationship? I mean, I'm sure, you know, people would be thinking of different things. I think I saw Sita has mentioned mother and child, a very fantastic answer. I mean, I'm saying, you know, a relationship between a couple, for example, husband and wife, I just came from Anjani. True friendship, absolutely wonderful. Trust between two friends, absolutely wonderful. So these are, you know, some relationships we should look at. And then we say, what took us to, you know, get to a great employer-employee relationship? And then see, can we, you know, follow those principles with our customers? Why? Because, you know, you can give comfort only after the customer gets comfortable, he starts taking more interest in you. We buy from a person, you know, with whom we are more comfortable, thinking that, yeah, he is trustworthy and he is open, dependable, etc. So I know, you know, we have completed an hour, Rashesh. I think it's going to take another 10, 15 minutes. Then we can still continue for our question and answer session, unless you want me to go very fast.
No, Rashesh, you can go ahead as per your schedule. Don't worry. We have time.
So then, you know, I'm talking about the comfort. So comfort, you look at it. What made you comfortable buying from one particular vegetable vendor as compared to the other vegetable vendor who's in the same building down? I think the comfort came because of certain things, you know. I mean, he told you, oh, nahi, ye mat lijiye, ye parsu ka hai. Ye parsu ka saman hai, ye mat lijiye. And, you know, then he said this twice. Maybe he is smarter than us. IIM candidates may not understand that, but he did emotional intelligence. I met an architect, you know, doing some work for me. She said, sir, why are you thinking about your client who is going to occupy that place? It is your property. You are just giving on rent. Why do you want to spend high quality? So she tried to convince me that she is, you know, on my side. So what is it that goes into this comfort making we can see? And, you know, let us look at the first. The first is, you know, listening tips. Listening means only ears, or more than listening, more than ears. And it's like, you know, a technique mentioned, you know, about listening. Our problem is that we sometimes, somebody said more than ears, and somebody said with mind. So I'm saying, you know, how does the opposite person come to know that you are listening? My problem has been pathetic in this area, so I am not the right person to talk about listening. I mean, a few days back, you know, I and my family were discussing something, you know, which is very sensitive, and my daughter gave a solid suggestion. And when she was talking about the suggestion, I was walking away from her to my room, and she just threw a fit. I mean, I realized that, oh my God, I think, you know, when you are somebody is talking on this kind of an issue, you need to stand in front of the person and show in your eyes that you have understood the point that is being made. And your body language also can change a lot to make the person understand, you know, what sensitivity of the issue the person is talking about. So the one is, every time, you know, when the customer is talking, most of us are so intelligent that by 50%, 60% of the time, we understand what he's saying and we are ready to answer. And we start answering it at 70% of his completion, and 30% is not completed only. And that is when problem, you know, is common with me and many people. So people tell me, Naresh, why don't you wait for 1 second? Allow me to complete. After my complete 1 second, you still don't speak. You know what you have to answer. I'm understanding that. But don't speak for 1 second and give me that feeling that you have listened to the whole story and your body shows me that you have listened to that story. I mean, eyes, body, God has given such a beautiful face that, you know, when you look at some actors, you can say what expressions they show by their body on the face. So this would be a lovely technique, you know, to remember. And then, you know, we move to the second slide. Oh, what's why this is very hung? Yeah. Now, clients will listen to you only after you have shown them that you will listen. You listen. If you listen, after 3 years, 2 years time, if you tell them, no, boss, this is not correct, this candidate is correct, then, you know, you have achieved a position of strength where you can have a, you know, that kind of a feedback to the customer, and the customer will respect you for that. Yeah. Now, I mean, a love relationship can't be hurried. A relationship of love can't be hurried. It takes time. Seven sittings, eight sittings in Starbucks or Cafe Coffee Day or, you know, beach, and understanding each other. So you have to give time, you know, to build a relationship. I mean, if this relationship, which is the ultimate, a mother-child relationship, is like unending giving. Here, you know, also you have to understand each other. So, I mean, can't be hurried. And this, if it can't be hurried, then how can business be hurried? How can we understand and expect that a business relationship will be formed in 3 months or three visits, four visits of a tough customer, of a big customer who's already having a good supplier already? It may not be possible. So the hard seller sometimes, you know, ignores the need for consent, the consent of the other party. If you, you know, try to hard sell, no, sir, I think this is actually the benefit of this product and I'll be very happy if you buy today. And then the guy has not made up his mind to buy this candidate today. I think then, you know, it will not happen. The hard selling will actually be ignoring his consent. Now, I think this is, again, you know, a little bit of, technical stuff, again, taken from a good book, you know, where it talks about challenging customers. Now, this word empathy, you know, I have learned one thing in my Glaxo trainings, that whenever somebody has an objection or somebody has a serious objection, and we know that answer and we say, yes, but, yes, but, yes, but, then, you know, we are actually telling him that you are wrong and I am right. Now, the empathy taught me one thing, that, you know, you acknowledge. The word is not accept. The word is not accept. The word is acknowledge the pain of the person. Saying, you know, I can understand, I think this has led to a lot of pain to you. It is not because of me. I'm not saying that. I'm not saying that the pain is because of me. I'm saying I can see that the pain has been there because of this issue. I fully see that, you know, you are disturbed because of this. Now, two lines, and you see the body language of this guy coming back now from 108 degrees to 89, 90 degrees in two lines. But if you say, no, sir, but I did my best. I tried to do search. Everything was done for this candidate, but it failed. So you have not understood the pain of this person and not acknowledged. I mean, we see sometimes the fight of, you know, two bulls in the office where, you know, one guy says something and the other guy reacts. So reaction, you know, was good in the chemistry laboratory, not in the office. Office, it is better to, you know, keep things positive. Say, okay, let us see how we can solve this. Let us see how we can solve this so that the problem is solved and the confidence of the customer is restored. I think that is the idea of the whole discussion. So when this, you know, dealing with an angry customer, I think very interesting line it said, you know, that when you are dealing with an agitated customer, you know, I mean, nowadays I don't know what is the value system every one of us has. But, you know, for example, when I was young, I would not have dared to respond in any aggressive way to my father or my mother when I was small, because I respected them. Now, here it is saying, you know, when dealing with an angry customer, please remember a rule that you assume that you are talking to a family member whom you respect or a senior friend whom you respect. So you cannot become angry and you cannot become reactive, and you really would like to solve the problem rather than reacting. And then, you know, there's another small technique. You know, this I think we'll skip because it's a little technical. It talks about, you know, showing the customer that, yes, you have understood the urgency. Use words and phrases, you know, which are given the message that, yes, I completely understand that, you know, you are wanting this position filled in 3 days. Give me just 3 or 4 days. I think we will try to work it out. Now, if you pace a little faster than the customer or a slower than the customer also, then there is an issue. I think, you know, examples are, you know, when we walk, I mean, even I walk with my wife sometime down the in the walking area. And many times I walk a little fast and I'm leaving her behind. So I think that is not liked by anybody. I think that is not liked by anybody. I think we should be at the same pace. Now, you know, the last few slides before we come to something, you know, which is more exciting is, you know, two options. We can take our car and go to Mahabaleshwar. The path of least resistance. Earlier, you know, there used to be resistance when there was an old highway and there is an old ghat to be traversed. But today, it is a flat thing. You know, you don't even know that there is a ghat between Bombay and Pune. So, the path of least resistance. And then you rarely land at a place which is like exciting. But if you take your two-wheeler and you go to Leh Ladakh, I mean, then, you know, you are likely to have a path which is going around the cliff, dangerous path. I mean, you know, some of these paths could be dangerous, but they, when you see down, I think, you know, it will be exhilarating. It will be wow. And when you reach on the, you know, really the Leh Ladakh, you will be able to say that it was worth taking all the trouble, taking the oxygen, you know, one day earlier and all that. So in our, you know, business journeys also, we have both these paths. The path which is taken, you know, a little, you know, with a little more, you know, challenge is more rewarding. It's more rewarding. So choose, I think, what makes us, you know, more fulfilled, more happier. I mean, we you know Darwin's theory, survival of the fittest, but actually the word has been changed. Survival of the one who is most adaptable to change. Not physically fittest, not having highest immunity against coronavirus, not having highest immunity against flu, but the one who is most adaptable to a changing situation. If he can be happy in the house for 21 days, he can survive. But if he is absolutely upset, then he will not survive. I have a tough customer, I have to adapt. I don't have a choice. I mean, I don't have a choice. I need to adapt to my customer. And I have to adapt means I have to not fall in line, but I have to respond in a way which he also agrees and understands. I think in the end, you know, it all boils down to what are we doing all this for? At the end, what is it that we are doing this for? We are doing this for being successful, being proud that we have been able to establish a business. And at the end, you know, it's, I'm sure it's of being happy. I mean, is there anything else for what we are going to do all this, you know, maramari? I mean, I would like to see some chats. What do you feel? Is this the two things or are there four or five other things which I'm missing? So we can, you know, quickly do some chats on this. Where is the chat for me? Yeah. So yeah, self-empowerment. Yes. I mean, this is something good. But I'm saying, you know, at the end of it, we are all, you know, doing this to be successful and happy. Successful and happy. Happiness, you know, needs to be there at the end of the journey. And, you know, and this is the most challenging tip. I mean, success is measured not by running a 100-meter race, you know, which is on a straight track. And on this track, a race run, you know, has, you know, a more accomplishment value. Now we are stopping again, and I'm going to take you completely to a non-business side. A non-business side, something to do with our persona, because we cannot be separated out from the business. We are all human beings, and we are happy because of certain reason or the other reasons. Yeah. I think I want now actual participation in the chat where I'm opening my chat and I'm asking you to think of one word or two word incidents, you know, which made you very happy in the, let us say, one and a half months before the lockdown or even during the lockdown maybe, but before the lockdown will be more interesting to me. What is it that made you feel very happy? What was that occasion where, you know, you felt very happy? Can you just quickly put it on the chat as quickly as possible? Jimit Shah, helping someone, one closure after 9 months for a company. Wow. Younger brother's marriage, got a chance to meet all the relatives. Wonderful, Vijita. Yeah. Okay. Goddess on the loose to everyone. Okay. This is from this person and selling my drawings. Okay. I think recruiting properly. Yeah. Okay. First closure after deciding to be an, wow. Absolutely. I think our first closure is, a very big occasion. My child getting an A grade in the same subject that he didn't do well earlier. And then client appreciation. Yeah, absolutely wise. Yes. Sometimes, you know, it could be a great dinner. Sometimes it could be a great movie. Sometimes it could be something, you know, to in a gym. I did a, and nowadays, you know, people are doing a lot of Zumba. So that could be there. And it can also be. And, you know, I'm seeing client appreciation. My son said he won't celebrate his birthday party and celebrate. Wow. Hiral. This is, there are two wows so far in this, I saw. I mean, why I'm saying wow, I will come to that a little later. First closure after six months. Okay. Now, I think, you know, I think we have time. So we will move now. So now I'm asking, you know, you to try and mentally classify these things into two happinesses. One happiness is, you know, the mind and body happiness, and one is the soul happiness, S-O-U-L, S-O-U-L happiness, soul happiness. So I, you know, saw two comments. One was saying one of helping somebody else, and one said, you know, that my son decided to celebrate the birthday in a old age, place. If you go back to 4 years, 5 years, you may be able to recollect the happinesses which were associated with your soul image a lot more than the ones, which are body and this. So what we are going to see is, one study, I have not put it here because it's so tiny in terms of the document. India stands 140th in rank in terms of happiness quotient. Are people happy? The answer is 148. 40 number out of, I don't know how many, less than 200 companies were surveyed. Now, there's a latest book, which is doing the rounds, which is Ikigai. Ikigai is a Japanese book, which is talking about why people in some of these blue zones are living at 103, 104 years of age also. So we'll talk about that a little later. I want you to look at, this few aspects about the, let me go to this, what I want to show. So I think I need the feedback whether the volume is there for this at your end. If it's not there, then I will immediately have to look at the correction. Yeah, so the volume is there?
No, there's no volume at our end.
Okay. Then I think I need to fix this. Give me just 1 minute because this is a video. I need to just go to the full screen. Not yet.
Rushi?
1 minute. I'll just call my daughter Pooja. I think there's a small functionality which has to be maybe changed. Stop sharing screen. Okay. 1 minute. I'll have to stop sharing the screen and make a little adjustment. Sure. It's a good one. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay, that's okay now. Okay, let's
see. Yes, we can see.
Ki ma boli maru phai
Yeah, so I think this was a video, you know, by one NGO. I think which talks about the joy of giving. Yeah, Rishesh, can be heard, no? Can be heard?
Yes, very much. Go ahead.
Yeah. So now, I think we're going to go very fast now. I think it's not that I need to have 20 lakh rupees in my bank to be happy. I think if you see the smile on this girl's face, I think I don't know whether I smiled like this for the last 5 years when I was a 3 years when I was a CEO. I mean, I may not have smiled like this. I think this is an old lady who's, you know, saying, don't worry about the money. You just take the apples and enjoy. First you take, because these people are saying that I don't mind giving because I don't have anything. I mean, if I don't have, I know it's okay to have nothing. I mean, it also touch lives, you know, like birds in the summer, you know, when there is going to be scarcity of water for them to drink. And this is how they, you know, really struggle for water. And keeping a small water pond, you know, water, whatever you call it, you know, in the balcony or outside the window also could be very, very valuable. I mean, I remember, you know, 26 January or January or 15th August, so many small boys carrying this, selling, you know, for 10 rupees or 20 rupees maximum. People sometimes don't buy. I mean, I'm saying, why don't we buy 5 and 10 and, you know, give it to 5 friends and 10, at least make these fellows really happy. For 10 rupees today, what do you get? I think we don't get a cup of tea also. So, I mean, you know, these are, in my opinion, you know, like likes and like, which are going to be more valuable than the Facebook likes. Because, you know, in the end of the journey, these likes is, you know, what will make a lot of difference. I don't know how many of you know about this great guy called Devi Prasad Shetty, head of Narayana Rudralaya in the southern part of India. He's a open heart surgeon. He learned when he was in Calcutta in Birla Hospital, he treated the lady, you know, who was Mother Teresa. And Mother Teresa spoke to him few lines. And because of those few lines, you know, he has started completely charity-based or a completely customer-centric heart institute in southern part, closer to Bangalore. They don't make that kind of money because if you have a heart attack, you know, it's minimum 5 lakhs, 7 lakh rupees. But these guys, based on one statement, the statement that Mother Teresa made was, hands that help are holier than lips that pray. I think he took the message clearly. We read this again and again, again and again. I also read it, but again, you know, it should hit you where it should hit, right, you know, at the heart. It should not go into the brain because this message is not for the brain at all. Yeah, then, you know, I mean, there's a book written being a go-getter. No go-getter, go-giver. Be a go-giver and be a reason for someone to smile today. Someone, you know, to smile today. And really, that may make us a lot of happy. I mean, what I'm saying is, you know, my building has got a liftman, 5 liftmen, 5 people are picking up the garbage every day without fail. I think we are buying oranges. Why not 5533 oranges for all of them? I mean, small thing to do. But again, we are so busy sometimes that, you know, we expect them to do. Whilst we don't want to even go out. So they are expected to do. So, I mean, it helps, you know, we have already seen the video. So we'll go to the last slide of the presentation now. Yeah. So after all this, you know, my last slide, you know, is, you know, really a summary of all that we discussed. And what I'm going to leave you to answer this at your own pace is after 2 years, 3 years, you know, with this business, what do you really wish to be remembered? For remembered as by your customers as a real trusted service provider, by Rashesh, best ever franchisee partner, you know, who really showed resilience, took 6-7 months, but after that he started showing, you know, results with some tough customers, and really energetic and inspiring leader. Whom, see, leader means not only people down the line, you know, whoever you are speaking to should get excited, should get a positive message. His positive button in the heart should be pressed. Then, you know, it makes a difference. And as a go-giver, who really, you know, like gives first to the customer, gives to the underprivileged, gives to the birds, gives to the dogs on the street, and really gets happy. I mean, it is a pleasure, you know, to do these kind of things live. But today, I think we have done it on Zoom. I'm not sure about the impact because, you know, when you see people, we can see the eyes, see the body language, and a lot of change there, you know. So I'll stop the presentation and go back to our video. And I'll say thank you very much again for allowing me to drag this by 20, 30 minutes. I had indicated to Rashesh that this will be a little longer, but once I get a little involved, then it takes a little longer. Sorry for that. So I will now pass it back to Rashesh, and then if there are question answers, I will attempt. I'll try to see if I can answer.
Thank you, Naresh. I really appreciate you spending time this time. What came across during the presentation was more about you speaking from your heart and speaking in terms of your experience. What I'm going to do is, I understand we're supposed to end this presentation by 5:30. So we will take around 3 to 4 questions, keeping in mind the paucity of time. If there are any questions by anybody in the audience, just put in a quick message on the chat, and then we will ask you to switch on your mic and take it further. So Naresh, there is one question from someone called 024336. How, in your opinion, can one be a trusted partner for a candidate and for a client? So this is, believing it's a recruiter in my organization. She's asking, how does one be a trusted partner for a candidate and for a client? I think this will be great for you in terms of, you know, your client perspective as a CEO of an organization earlier.
Yeah. I think, you know, there would be good answers with Rashesh also. But what I would feel is, you know, that if I feel that there's an urgency for a recruitment and I feel that this candidate is not the best fit, but he's fitting in terms of the urgency speed and he's fitting in terms of the CTC, I would I would advise him that, you know, the environment there is not what would suit him. So I will not hurry up just because I want to fill a vacancy, and I'll do something, you know, which is really good for both the client and the candidate, and not give a candidate something, you know, which is not going to be really nice for him in the future. Second thing I may do is, you know, I mean, once we have identified a candidate, you know, this candidate as at 30 has another 30 years to work. So how many of us, you know, keep in touch with this candidate every 2-3 months to check how are you feeling in the new company? Are you happy? I mean, again and again, not to try and tell him to switch because I will get 13%. That's not the idea. The idea is, you know, to say, I mean, are you happy? I was very, very serious that, you know, this is a good fit for you. It gives you also a feedback, but it also gives this guy that, you know, you didn't forget him after your assignment, you know, was finished. So that would be good. And I think in terms of the clients, I think, you know, as I said, very in the beginning, maybe, you know, really doing something more than what they're expecting us, particularly some more research, you know, on the client, and giving them those 2-3 paragraphs, which, you know, we may not be actually getting remuneration for, but that helps them to take a final call on the candidate. So if they see some line, you know, I mean, there are so many profiling sheets being done by people, and those profiles are very accurate. So if you can, you know, all do a profiler, you know, which is a software profiler, asking some 10 questions and coming out of the profile, and, you know, show that profile also to the client, that does it suit you? I mean, it might really add tremendous value as a differentiation, and also as, you know, something, you know, where the trust will build. And you will say, and out of these 3 candidates, you know, while this guy is fitting the CTC, but this guy is not, but, you know, from these 3 points, I think this guy might be really good. So that will help.
Okay. I think that was Chandrasekhar who asked the question.
Yeah.
Are there any more questions? If you could raise your hand in the chat box, and I'll call upon you to, switch on your mic.
Yeah, actually, I think I couldn't see the name of Mr. Chandrasekhar because this was showing a number. So maybe he's not put his number. Yes. Nice question, Mr. Chandrasekhar. I think really nice question because this is the heart and soul of the business. So very important. Yeah. So I think, you know, we can take at least 5 questions also, because I'll try. If I know the answer, I will say fast. But if I don't know, then, you know, I'll request you to appreciate the small answer also, short answer also.
Sure. Yeah. So we'll wait if there are more questions right now. There are a few participants who are still on the chat. There are 48 of them which are present, and if there are any questions, we'd like to take them on.
Yeah. I think they can talk also. I mean, if you want to go into
they know they'll turn on the mic if they have a question.
If
any of you have a question, please feel free to turn on your mic and you know, can ask the question.
I think maybe we can, apart from the PBT, the additional takeaways you would like to give us for 2020. Yeah. See, I think the takeaways would be, I think there will be more challenges. The only way forward is, you know, to try and give more and try and, you know, see that we are more resilient and don't get demoralized, because things may take little time, you know, between life and economy. I think it looks like the life is more important for all of us now, and economy may take a little beating. So we can wait a little with patience and do as much as possible on the, you know, Zooms, etc., and utilize this time to build our own, you know, whatever interests, talent. If you want to read, if you want to listen to some music which you didn't get time to listen, I mean, mix of things, you know, which really makes you happy in this situation, because happiness is directly proportional to immunity of the body also, as a pharmacy guy, I can tell you. And the second thing about 2020 is, you know, a good time, you know, to get back to 30, 40 candidates whom you were in touch with, try to assess some of these candidates. I'm talking about the business point of view. I mean, I, for my own part, I've started realizing how much important, you know, these house helps are. I mean, when we have to do it ourselves, we feel that, you know, the amount of money we are paying to these people is very less. And some of this is quite tough job and not a very happy job. I think a lot of learnings, you know, we are also spending more time with our family. I'm spending time on my laptop and my reading also. But a lot of things, you know, which are different in the last 1.5 month. Yeah.
Good evening. I have a question, Mr. Naresh. Chandrasekhar.
Yes. Yeah, Mr. Chandrasekhar.
Yeah, it was a very good session. Thank you very much for your very good inputs.
Thank you so much.
And under the current circumstances, because of this COVID, so what are the good opportunities for the recruitment? Because we are in the recruitment industry, which sectors might be going to be good, healthy for us? So which we can anticipate the?
Yeah, I think, you know, see, there is going to be, simple thumb rule is whatever consumption, you know, did not come down, actually went up. The consumption of FMCG goods went up, groceries went up a lot, you know, medicines went up a lot, medicines cannot be stopped. So a lot of services have gone. Then, you know, if you are supporting those companies, you know, who are going to serve international clients, once things open up, there may be a lot of overload. There will be suddenly overload also, and whatever, you know, has been lost, people might like to cover up. So you will have to keep mapping, you know, which clients are likely to jump more faster and get up faster than the others. I think it may take little time, you know, for the automobiles, for the loans, and, you know, for the real estate to jump up. But the things, you know, which have to be bought either, you know, for personal consumption or for your own business running smoothly will continue. That is my thought. But one suggestion I will also give you is you all should have more of your interactive, you know, sessions where, you know, feedback can be shared from one franchisee to the other franchisee also. That would be wonderful.
Yeah, because why I ask this specific question is, so when we are going through the movie news channels, so there is a news that a lot of companies are going to, attrition will be there and layoff will be there, job losses will be there. So that is the basic reason of asking this question. Yeah.
I think, you know, I mean, we cannot predict exactly which companies there will be a, you know, need for. I mean, I don't see pharma doing that at all. I think, you know, the big bazaars or the groceries or the FMCGs will come down, because we continued to buy the FMCG goods. We continued to buy, people who never had washing machines will buy washing machines immediately. So there may be so many new people who will buy washing machines because they realize the importance of a washing machine now. So, I mean, different companies will behave differently. So, yeah. It's not right to think that everybody is going to downsize. Because why will they downsize? You know, the downsizing means if they want to catch up, catch up can be done with the same number or with the maybe little bit 2-3 months. There may be a delay because you know there no revenues have happened for some companies in the last 2-3 months, but this is not going to be indefinite. I think things will change within 3-5 months.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you very much for your kind inputs.
Yeah, my pleasure. My pleasure.
Naresh, there's a question from Vijita. She's asking, you know, specifically during the start of the business or at times in the middle as well, there are times when, you know, when things are not going as well, you know, and the results are not yet coming. What is the best way to keep yourself motivated?
Not easy, Vijita. I can understand. Very frankly, not a very straightforward answer that, you know, you read a Paul Coelho book and get motivated. It doesn't happen like that. Now, you know, the understanding, you know, if you compare this, you know, times with the farmers, if you compare these times with the people who are on the Siachen Glacier and working for us with much, much more difficulties, then, you know, a mindset of relativity comes in, you know, that, sometimes it's taking tougher. And sometimes, you know, it takes little time. Patience is running out because, you know, our incomes are dependent on this. If there are employees, people are dependent on this. But I would be, you know, we talked about resilience, but how does that resilience word translate into reality is, you know, your ability to not pass on that demotivating thing to your family or to your any subordinate. Because, you know, if they become demotivated, then even that whatever work comes to their plate, I think they may not be able to do the best part. So motivation and come through hope, you know, through a lot of hope, which should be based on reality that things will improve. I mean, and if you are not breaking through a customer, then, you know, I would personally also feel that good idea to try and sometimes fix a 10-minute call with that person's HR, somebody down the line, to try and take feedback that, you know, I genuinely want to know what else we can do to, you know, try and come up to your expectations. The choice of words should be such that the person keeps thinking that you are seriously, you know, interested and you are unable to open the door. So take, you know, feedback, either the middle management person or the HR person, whoever. Yeah. Yeah, Vijita.
Yeah, so I don't think there are any more questions, Narishji.
Yeah, okay.
I appreciate you spending time with us today. It's really kind of you to take out time to pen down your thoughts, to present, to make the presentation and actually share it with us. Experience is the best teacher. And you having been there for 35 years in an industry, I'm sure there's lots that you've learned and there's lots that you've put. And I understand that there could be a discomfort of doing this on a webinar. You know, there is a different feeling when one does it on a one-to-one basis. Having said that, thank you so much for spending time with the team, and we look forward to interacting with you more.
Yeah, I think my pleasure, really my pleasure to have interacted with such a lovely audience and very interactive audience. And I know all of us are having, you know, tough times. In my case, I have just, you know, retired from my long drawn corporate work, and I'm getting into management consultancy. So we have to keep positive. We have to keep trying harder, with a lot of smile on our face, even if there is a little pain inside. I mean, that pain should not be seen very freely with a customer at least, or a subordinate at least. That is the, you know, last line which is important for me. And we should be the, you know, shock absorbers, you know, as leaders. So all the best to you all. I think we'll be
trying to... Okay, if I can share your email address to the participants so that if they need to reach out to you, they can reach out to you.
Most welcome. I will also share my LinkedIn ID and my Facebook account if people want to connect, and if they want to leave a one-line feedback on my LinkedIn account, that would be very helpful. And also, you know, feel free to email me any questions. I will be happy to even connect over a phone call to talk. Absolutely fine with me.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you so much, Naresh. Appreciate this time you spent. Thank you.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye-bye.